Good morning. You braved the weather and you made it to church. God bless you all. Welcome. Welcome to Irvine United Congregational Church as we celebrate who we are as a proud, open, and affirming just peace, global missions, creation justice, progressive Christian congregation of the United Church of Christ. Here we strive to be multicultural, multi-generational, ever expanding in our welcome and in our desire to evolve as a community. That said, today is Evolution Sunday. Now, that's not an actual liturgical holy day, but there aren't a whole lot of churches that celebrate it. However, there are some. It is actually the 19th time it's been observed. And I think I've been a part of it for at least 15 of those times. This is our third time celebrating Evolution Sunday. It began as a clergy letter writing project to respond to creationists. And then it turned into a whole day. And then a weekend as different faith traditions joined on. And now it's really a celebration of faith and science. In fact, nationally, I learned that they changed the name to Religion and Science Day, but it's hard for me to change. It's hard for me to evolve. So we're still celebrating it as Evolution Sunday because we are going to talk a little bit about evolution today, but we will also celebrate the happy coexistence of science and religion in our faith observation, tradition, and practice. Some Christians would have you believe that evolution is fake, that the world is only a couple thousand years old, that dinosaurs either never existed or that humans and dinosaurs coexisted at the same time. Their need to be biblical literalists has stunted their ability to understand scientific fact. And this really puts a bad name on Christians. And so that is why we come together to proactively celebrate science and evolution, grateful that we can continue to learn and evolve, grow, adapt, and become. As progressive Christians, we're not really biblical literalists here. We take the Bible seriously, but not always literally. At Irvine United Congregational Church, you don't have to check your brain at the door. So welcome. If you're a visitor, welcome. We know that it might not look like a church service you find anywhere, but we like to say we're that church, and you're not going to get that everywhere. So today we have a scientist at the pulpit, and we're excited to embrace this opportunity. So thank you for joining us. If you're a visitor, thank you so much for getting to know us. We're going to have not only visitors, but extra guests with our guests, and we hope that you'll stay during our coffee hour time to get to know some of our little friends who are here to meet us. As a visitor, we hope you'll take the time to fill out a green welcome card. Those are located just at the welcome table outside the narthex. If you're watching online or you prefer to go online, you can simply go to iucc.org/visitor and fill out the card that way so we can reach back out to you and properly welcome you to church. If you're watching online, we especially want to thank you for joining us and remind you that this is Communion Sunday, so you could get your elements. A little later on, we'll all participate in communion. And here at IUCC, we believe in open communion. That means that any and all are invited to the table, but no one is expected or pressured to come to the table. We will practice this. We've begun our post-pandemic tradition now is to take both the cup and the bread and return to our seats, and then together we'll all partake in the sacrament together when we get to that moment of time. As a Green Faith Church, we no longer print paper bulletins, but if you're the type that likes to know what's going to happen next, you can simply download the QR code, which is heading up right here. Take your phones, download it, and follow along. If you're here in person and you have a little bit of challenge with hearing, we do have some devices available. Those are available at the tech booth, and Donnie would be happy to set you up with them. So, I'm excited to introduce you to our guests. We have, in our third Observation of Evolution Sunday, an evolutionary biologist. In the past, we've had another evolutionary biologist who focused on fungi. Do you remember that? And last year, we learned about brains from a geneticist. Both of those were from UCI. Today, we get to welcome another evolutionary biologist, and this time entomologist, Dr. Boris Baer from the University of California, Riverside. Traveled. He's a global scientist whose work spans continents, and he's here to tell us about insects, bugs, and faith. It doesn't get any better than this. And truthfully, though insects can be small and scary at times, our existence is dependent upon theirs. I'm looking forward to hearing from Dr. Baer, who specializes in ants and bees. And if you know me, you know I already love bees. We had, on Earth Day last April, we had the president of the Orange County Beekeepers Association, and now we are taking it next level. So again, following our sermon by Dr. Baer, we will engage in our Sacrament of Communion. There's a lot happening here at IUCC. Do check out the website, find out what we're doing, scan the megaphone QR code that's in your hymnals. Next week, we have Fat Sunday. That's a fun day as we bid the season of Epiphany farewell with special music and a taste of Nolens with David Carruthers and his band. And Alex Engel will delight us with his King's Cake. If you didn't find a baby in the Rosca del Reyes in Epiphany Sunday, you have one more chance to find the baby in the sweet King's Cake that's coming next week. Then Ash Wednesday falls on Valentine's Day again. And that's kind of weird. I'm sorry. I don't plan the liturgical calendar. But I hope that you'll join us for this holy day that opens us up to the season of Lent. And of course, once we begin Lent, most people put away with all the crazy things. Not us. We've got Broken Hearts Bingo on February 16th. So we hope that you'll sign up for that. Cuckoo Chanel and her friends will be delighting us once again. So now we take a deep breath and we embrace this moment. Thankful that we can be a progressive Christian community that comes together for one another to learn and grow and evolve and connect as we connect with our God and this community. So welcome to IUCC.
Good morning. I am Alex Engel, and this is Daisy Engel. Today, she's dressed up like a frog, and she has little butterflies to celebrate Evolution Sunday. And yes, John is back. He is recovering from his 3-month trip to the Philippines, so that's why he's not here today. But he will be back next week, hopefully. All right, so I will be your worship leader this morning. And if you would join me for the call of worship, it's found in the digital program or on the screens. Beneath the mist of time, before the world began, beyond our understanding, in the beginning, God.
Father in history, mother in creation, everything earth's people from the beginning, God.
Expecting the right moment, preparing the right way, revealing the right person for each new beginning, God.
Maker and mover of heaven and earth, ever evolving, continually calling, perpetually pushing.
Creator God, one God, our God.
Good morning, church. It's time for us to sing together. We will be singing from our hymnal today. If you look next to you in your seat, you'll find a hymnal that kind of looks like this. If you are not the kind of person that loves to look at the little black dots going by, you can look up at the words on the screen and follow along too. This is number 556, 556. It is called God Who Stretched the Spangled Heavens, and we'll sing verse 1, 2, and 3, all the verses. So 556, please stand in body or spirit, God Who Stretched the Spangled Heavens.
Crikey mates, we're back for another episode of Fresh Word. Today as a church, we're celebrating Evolution Sunday, so I'm out in the wild, observing wildlife, rhyming and their natural habitat. Let's go. Crikey, we found ourselves a crocodile. Here's a fun fact. Did you know that crocodiles have remained relatively unchanged for over 200 million years, making them one of the oldest reptile lineages on Earth? You might also be wondering what the difference is between a crocodile and an alligator. Well, a crocodile you see in a while, and an alligator you see later. On Evolution Sunday, we celebrate the power of science, so I want to hear you share a cool science fact.
Church, some of the facts that come to mind when I think about science facts are lobster blood is blue, and there's a type of volcanic rock that diamonds are in. Keep it fresh!
Hello, church. Did you know that the best place to make French fries are on Jupiter because it has three times Earth's gravity? Hello, church. Did you know that the biggest magnet on Earth is actually the Earth?
My royal nose is colder than the rest of my body. This unique trait enables me to locate small mammals up to 5 feet away by detecting their heat signature.
Hi, my name is Jinte from Troop 691, and my fun science fact is that a cloud can weigh up to and around 1 million pounds.
Hi, I'm Sebastian Alexis from Troop 691, and my cool science fact is that your smartphone is 900 million times more powerful than the computer that landed people on the moon.
Hi, I'm Sonia from 691, and my cool science fact is that bananas are radioactive.
Hello, my name is Anderson. The cool science fact is that an earthworm has 5 hearts.
You know, the problem with being out in the wild is that mosquitoes won't stop you to bother. Here's another fun fact. Did you know that only female mosquitoes bite? So, I guess you could say, I'm quite popular with the ladies. Crikey. Sounds like a tiger. Well, I'd better get out of here before I pick up this dinner. Until next time, keep it fresh.
Thank you.
Let's sing together as we come into prayer together.
Holy Spirit, come to us. 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 Fill us with your love, Holy Spirit, come to us. Be in our hearts today, lead us forward in our understanding.
Please pray with me. Holy Creator, we lift our hearts and minds to you this morning. We're exploring the idea of evolution today, and we know there was a time when churches would not have even thought about addressing evolution in a church service. But thankfully, God, we have evolved beyond that controversy. In our evolving work for social justice today, we recognize how Jesus turned the prevailing beliefs of power upside down by designating a child as the model for understanding your message to us humans. He also compels us to love those who are marginalized in society. In the Old Testament, Job counsels us to learn by going and asking the wild animals and the birds, the flowers and the fish, and I'm sure the insects. Any of them can tell you what the Lord has done, because every living creature is in the hands of God. Learning from creation around us can help us be more tuned into your vision for us. The Apostle Paul wrote to the church in Rome, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect." We are in a time of testing right now, but that is often what helps us evolve in our understanding and practices, and helps us realize that we need your guidance. We don't always get to see what is good and acceptable and perfect around us. In fact, right now things seem to be in chaos and out of control, with atmospheric rivers on one hand and periods of extreme heat on the other. And things are also heating up in the Middle East as your children fight over who has the rights to live on what land. In Psalm 33, we read that you love righteousness and justice, and that the earth is full of your unfailing love. Help us witness that love in places where it is hard to see. Help our leaders remember your steadfast love for all your children, no matter their culture or religion. We pray for wisdom to find a way when there seems to be no way. Give us hope, Holy Creator, We need it right now. There are those in our community, God, who have requested our prayers for situations in their lives that are difficult, and their names will be shown on the screen. So, as a community that stands for justice and kindness, we pray that we will continue to evolve as the earth continues to revolve, and we will continue our resolve to address those problems that have been caused by negligence, ignorance, and greed. So, as we continue our humble walk with you, God, we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Creator, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We are grateful this morning for the many gifts, talents, and contributions which sustain our community. If your heart is suggesting a financial contribution, you may drop an offering in the plate this morning. You can visit our website at iucc.org/giving, or you can mail a check into 4915 Alton Parkway. You can also pay with electronic payment, which can be sent through Zelle, and you can also donate through texting. Simply text the amount you want to give to 949-776-3663, and then follow the prompts. At this time, I'd like to invite our deacons to come forward to help with the offering.
Thank you.
thank you for the generosity of these gifts. May we use them to further Jesus' ministry of inclusion, seeking justice, sharing joy, and living love. Amen. Today's scripture is from Sirach chapter 11, verse 3. The bee is small among flying creatures, but what it produces is the best of sweet things.
Today, we're welcoming evolutionary biologist and entomologist, Dr. Boris Baer. He researches social insect reproduction and immunity by studying Australian honeybees, Panamanian leaf-cutting ants, European and American bumblebees. He uses an integrative approach which combines biochemical technology and evolutionary biology. He conducts biochemical analysis and uses their outcomes to formulate hypotheses that can be experimentally tested in the field. That might make sense to UCLA professor over here. I'm not sure the rest of us, but I'm excited to learn what that means. He has built a new field of research, which he refers to as evolutionary proteomics. He aims to understand evolutionary processes at the protein level, but also attempts to quantify variations in proteomic profiles and investigate their consequences for natural and sexual selection. He's been educated at the University of Zurich, Switzerland, where he received his bachelor's, master's, and PhD. Dr. Baer went on to research at the University of Western Australia and now teaches at the University of California, Riverside, where he continues his research and runs the Center for Integrative Bee Research. He's received a multitude of awards along the way. My favorite was the Busy Bee Award he got from the Western Australian Apiarist Association. In learning about you, I discovered that your partner in life is also your partner in science. In an article cleverly titled, The Bears and the Bees, I learned that together you and your wife, Barbara Baer, who founded the world-renowned Center for Integrative Bee Research, or CYBER, which is served to serve as a beekeeping think tank. The center is now based at UC Riverside, where they are, and it is one of the largest honeybee health networks in the country, enabling entomologists, engineers, economists, and professional beekeepers to collaborate on innovative solutions for colony collapse. And it's possible that we have even more guests, as I referred to earlier, to meet with following the service, and I'm sure you'll introduce us to them a little later as well. Thank you so much for joining us. Welcome to IUCC. Come on up here and we'll learn from you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thanks so much for the invitation. It's a special occasion for me to come here. We have a little bit of a problem.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so we have a little bit of a problem with the technology because we cannot really hook up my little presentation that I've prepared for you. So for the first service, I think I will show you the kind of slides here. It's basically more to remind me what I want to tell you rather than like for you to kind of really see all the details here. So why are we here? We are celebrating this man's birthday, Charles Darwin. He would have being 215 years today. And he was, of course, a very influential man for me and for many others. Because he kind of proposed quite kind of interesting new concepts. And when he did that, if I go one step further here, that is from his book here, if you can see that. It's an excerpt where he writes on the top here, I think. And then he has like what we would now call a phylogenetic tree, right? So, what did he really propose was really not just opposed by religious people, but even by scientists. They didn't kind of buy this at all. So he made a lot of kind of enemies through this by publishing it. He actually kind of was very hesitant to publish it for a very long time. But what was so kind of revolutionary about that? Well, what was revolutionary about it is that he said, well, Yeah, kind of. Oh, I shouldn't run around. Okay, okay, I will stand still. Yes. So what you see here is like what Charles Darwin basically kind of told us is that we are kind of all connected to each other. We're the end points of like a long trajectory of life. And if you go far enough back, we all have kind of common ancestors. So whether it's like this nice little dog or it's a tree out there, the further we go back, eventually we will be all part of that kind of extremely kind of rare experiment that we run here, which is called life. Okay? So if you look at like what is really driving this, where does that come from? Well, it comes from the fact that like we are all unique, right? Every kind of individual that is sitting in this room is very unique. And if you look at like animals, those animals have certain traits, and these traits give them benefits. And you can see here, I don't know, it's very difficult because it's a very small screen, but here in the middle here, you actually have a gecko, right? And I found that in the Panamanian rainforest, and I walked past that gecko for at least 3 weeks until I actually saw it. So a trait like this gives this gecko obviously really kind of an advantage because I don't see it, and that means that anything that wants to eat that gecko doesn't see it as well. So we call this natural selection for traits that give these animals an advantage. Now, Darwin was a fan of bees. We even called there are Darwin's bees. He used his children, and I did the same. He used his children to do bee research in his garden. He had beehives in his garden. Why was he so interested in bees? Well, he was so interested in bees because I told you that like if you have reproduction and you create new variation, that is like something that selection can act on. But plants have a problem with that because they are kind of linked to the ground. They cannot move around. So how did the plants solve that problem? Well, they solved the problem, and you can't see that here in the middle, by getting a messenger. And that messenger would help the plants to transport the pollen from one plant to the next and generate reproduction and generate the diversity that then selection can act on, right? And this was an absolute kind of success. And as it was a success, the plants started to diversify. And I don't have to show you all the plants that we have out there, all the colors, all the kind of variations around that. I want to show you what the bees did, because they did the same. And I want to show you some of those bees that have been created through like those kind of mechanisms that Darwin proposed. So here, for example, look at this bee here. Isn't that a little piece of art? What about this one here? You know? We have thousands of different bee species that have evolved. Some of them are highly specific in the way they actually interact with these plants. Some of these bees can only really pollinate a single plant, and the plant only is dependent on that single pollinator. Now, one of the bees that you probably all know are the honeybees. That species here, right? Which is really important for us because it also kind of does services for us. It pollinates more than 80 crops of agricultural interest. A third of what you eat depends on that animal there for crop pollination. That has substantial value. It's about worth on a global scale about $230 to $500 billion each year. It's worth for the United States agricultural sector about $29 billion. So we're really dependent on those bees. And as you might have heard, we took this for granted for a very long time, but over the last two or three decades, we have seen massive declines in bees. We lose them at a quite rapid speed, and in the last year alone, the beekeepers in the US lost about half of their colonies. Imagine we would lose half of our dogs, if we would lose half of our chickens. There would be an outcry, right? And that is like really kind of getting people concerned, especially at the moment where we have increasing food prices, right? And where the availability of food all of a sudden is not a given anymore. That's new since the COVID pandemic. And it's also kind of that the it has become unaffordable for a large part of the population. 51 million people in the US had to go to the food banks, as you can see there on the picture, to ask for food. So I think you all kind of agree with me that we have to save the bees at all costs. First of all, because they are beautiful little creatures. I have lost my heart very early on in my career to them, but we also need them because of the services that they provide to us. Now, that's really frustrating, and we live in a world that is really frustrating. Some of it has already been mentioned, but I want to end with a really positive story today. And that is like that you might not know that you live in an absolutely mystical place here. A mystical place of bees that are very, very unique, right here in Irvine. So why is this? Well, if you go out, and maybe you have seen that in your backyard, there are some bees, and they're in the trees. Sometimes they annoy you, right? That is very, very special because these bees survive without human intervention. And that is like a picture I took, I got from a beekeeper in Long Beach. So it's really, really close by here. Look at this beautiful hive, right? These hives are not dying. So what are these bees? And why are they able to kind of withstand really hot weathers? Why can they withstand all these kind of stressors that the managed bees that we normally keep in our boxes succumb to? So we had a look at this over the last 6 years, and we started to understand those bees. And we looked at this from a genetic point of view. So you can see the different colors here. On the right-hand side, you have a lot of red, and these bees are coming from Central and South America. It's a bee that was created in Brazil in 1957 as a hybrid to increase genetic diversity. And that increased genetic diversity was supposed to be helpful to create a more resilient, a more tolerant bee. That bee escaped, unfortunately, from that lab, and it got a really bad reputation. We sometimes refer to it as the Africanized or the killer bee. Right? And some of you might have been heard about that. On the other side there, you have like the usual bees that we keep. So in black and yellow and blue, you have the managed bees. So they're coming from Europe. That is what we kept in the box. So eventually, the Africanized kind of bees crossed the border into kind of California. And they met with these other bees because we transport about 1.2 million hives each year into California to secure our pollination in the Central Valley. So what happened here in this area? Well, they started to interbreed with each other. And what you can see there is like the bees that we find around Southern California. You can see it's a mosaic. It's a hybrid of all of these different kind of species, right? So we have here, very unique, and you find it nowhere else in the globe, the genetically most diverse bee in the world. And as I told you before, and what Darwin basically tells you, that is the raw material of natural selection. So we know from our work now, that those bees, they can withstand a lot of the stressors, they can deal with these the issues that other bees have, but some of them are more defensive. So we need to have a new deal. We make a new green bee deal with those bees, and we do that together with the beekeepers because we think those are the bees that can actually save us, because we are not going to lose them at the rate as we would lose other bees. And to do this, we have linked up with 5 different hobbies, beekeeping associations that we have here in Southern California, which is quite a lot. And together, we do the research and we start to kind of do work to basically set up a breeding program where we take those bees back into husbandry, we can propagate them, and we can distribute them then to beekeepers in California, but also in the rest of the world. And in the end, what we use is what Darwin gave us, right? The understanding of why these bees are created, why they are there, why they are so successful. And it's interesting that like we have this kind of movement now in the beekeeping world to basically allow bees to be more bees again and to kind of treat them nicer and to basically kind of take into account that it's a highly complex animal and that like we have to kind of take that into account when we want to have these bees around us and that they should be healthy. And I'm not saying the name for this that has been taken is Darwinian beekeeping. So thanks a lot. One final thing is that our bees, we call them survival bees, they brought you a gift, and that is some honey, and you can taste that honey outside.
We live and we learn and we grow and we are in community together. And as a symbol of our union, we embrace the sacrament of communion. And so we remember Jesus' final night with his friends, his disciples, his chosen family. And we recall that he took the bread that he'd shared with them that evening. And he lifted it. And he broke it. And he said, "This bread is broken. Broken like my body, like our world, like our very hearts. But every time you eat of it in our brokenness, may you be whole again, sustained to bring wholeness to our world." And likewise, he took a very simple cup that they had shared together, lifted it and poured once again. Saying, "This is the new covenant, a cup of blessings, a promise between me and you that you shall never be alone. That even as the world can be bitter, you also will taste its sweetness." And so it was that he invited his dearest friends back to table together. So it is. He invites his dearest friends to table together. "Come, for the meal has been prepared." Deacons, if you'll come forward.
Gentile or Jew, servant or free, woman or man, no more. One bread, one body, one Lord of all, one cup of blessing. Many
May we always find sustenance, renewal, and hope at this table of love. Will you join with me? For love shared and hope renewed. You're gonna have to carry me. I don't have my paper either. For love shared and hope renewed. For promises remembered and Christ among us. We give you this life and those to come. We give you thanks, O God. Send us forth to reconcile and make new, praising life in the midst of death, and bring hope on angels' wings, and giving thanks always and everywhere that life is precious beyond all telling. Hallelujah and amen. Brothers and sisters, siblings in Christ, go out into a world that, yes, has often been decimated by our own hands, but have hope, for we are ever evolving to do the work that God has called us to do, to care for every living thing, the birds and the bees, and everyone among us. Amen.